Moving on to the fifth game of the day, we have Unicorns of Love from Russia versus Detonation Focus Me from Japan. And as for Unicorns of Love bans, we have two strong meta champions on Xin Zhao and Amumu, and Ryze, who might not be an S tier champion, but his ultimate is very useful the way teams play in competitive. For dives, for escapes, for backdoors, you can use a lot of you can use Ryze's ultimate in a lot of ways. And for the side of DFM, they removed Camille and Irelia, which are one of the strongest picks both for the mid lane and for the top lane. I'm not sure if they banned Constantine because Noman's is playing this champion. I don't know. I mean, I know Unicorns of Love, but I only watch them every year at Worlds. So I'm not sure if the Constantine ban was targeted for Noman's. Anyway, doesn't matter. So we've seen now that for a second consecutive game, when Lee Sin is open, the blue side teams are first picking him. The same happens with MF almost every game, if I'm not mistaken. The red side teams are either picking MF either in the first pick or in the second pick. I don't like this LeBlanc pick so early from DFM because, like it happened with LNG, LeBlanc is open to counters like Galio, Vladimir and Malzahar. But unfortunately, Unicorns of Love picked Orianna. I mean, they had the chance to pick a counter pick to LeBlanc. They chose not to. I don't know what their planning was, but here, I also don't like the Lucian Rakan. We were expecting a Lucian Nami, maybe, or a Lucian Brom, but, and it's too early. Like, the only reason that I'm thinking that they picked Rakan is because they wanted to have a wombo combo with Rakan and Orianna. But they picked Orianna on their last pick, so they couldn't have known that Orianna would be available so late in the second ban phase, in the second pick phase, for them to pick this wombo combo. So that's why I'm saying that Rakan is a bit mismatched with Lucian. And of course, we have for DFM, we have the nice combo of MF and Leona, very well matched between them. And now, this is where it gets a bit cheesy in the second pick phase. First, DFM chose to ban Gwen, which was buffed in this patch, and Sylas, which is, I have him at least on my S tier list for the mid lane, and UOL, Set, and Poppy. I'm not sure about Poppy. Not saying that she's not strong as a champion. She can be played at least top and support, maybe jungle in the solo queue. I just think that teams haven't practiced her enough or give her much attention in order to see Poppy in this tournament. So that's why I'm saying that it's a bit of a weird ban, not because she's not strong or anything like that, but because teams were focusing more on this assassin jungler's meta, Amumu, Trinda Mermaid, stuff like that, instead of Poppy. Anyway, so finally, we see Talon in the jungle. Last game, we saw Zed, now we see Talon, so I think that teams are watching these champions played, like officially, and they're thinking that, okay, let's try this, it's still the play-ins. I mean, every match counts, but they have prepared something with all these assassin junglers for sure. And this pick is like the worst pick that they could have possibly went for, because first, UOL picked Jayce with Orianna, so DFM knew that Jayce is top side, and they picked Gnar, which first is a useless pick anyway for this meta, and second is getting counterpicked from Jayce. Like, Camille, Jayce and GP are the three most well-known counters to Gnar. So this is an awful pick right here. The Talon pick is also risky because we haven't seen this work in competitive level, and this is an official game, so it's a risky pick to go for that. And yeah, I mean, I would give a small edge in terms of the draft. I would give a small edge to Unicorns of Love, but only a small one, because DFM, like I said, they have MF and Leona, which are very strong. LeBlanc is also a solid pick, but we don't know about Talon, and Gnar is an awful pick. Let's check the first plot of the game, which came from the first Talon gang. So now we immediately see Talon working as a jungler. He very smartly escapes the vision from the scuttle, and by jumping this wall, they close the gap with Jace, and they managed to kill him. Also, they had Mega Gnar form, so nice coordination here for DFM. And Lee Sin doesn't have anything to steal on the other side of the map from Steel. So nice coordination here from DFM to take this first blood, and also kind of taxes his top laner, but because he wants to help Gnar reset, he helped him crash this wave. Lee Sin realized that Gromp just came up, so he decided to cancel his recall to take it, to at least gain something versus Talon. And now I'm gonna talk about the top lane matchup, which is the most interesting part of the game. And I was watching a LS stream about that, and he made a very good point. So this is a good, this is a game mostly for a wave management discussion, and not, you know, to see something different that we haven't seen. So as you can see here, and as I said earlier, Gnar is getting countered from Jace, right? So now Jace, after frozing the waves on his side of the turret, now he slow pushes because his teammates are preparing for a dive. And of course, as a counter pick to Gnar, he out trades him, out wins on CS, and now he's starting getting a huge lead. You can see that his teammates, like I said, were preparing for a dive. Even Rakan roamed up there. Just a little trade from Talon and Lee Sin. So now Jace is very far ahead. He managed to hit level 6 first, and now they have control over top lane. And again here, another gank. Let me see how it started. So yeah, I mean, Lee Sin spent, I don't know, maybe 2 minutes in the top lane, and that's a really bad check from Gnar to check at this point. So they got him again, and like the game is lost. The top lane is lost right now for Gnar. Just as he managed to equal Jace on the farming, now he got killed again. Jace can push the wave to his turret, so now Gnar doesn't have teleport. He's gonna miss 2 waves, and Jace took also 1 plate, and now they're taking also Herald. But this is when it gets interesting. So I'm gonna put this on double speed because I'm not gonna show any other team fights. I just want to show you what LS was explaining, and this is a concept that some of the pro players don't do very often. So this was a nice game for educational purposes. Okay, I'm gonna move it forward. So Jace got another plate, and this is where it gets interesting. So first of all, Gnar bought fades while losing his lane, and Lee Sin is always top. He's camping him, and instead of buying like a Bramble Vest or the Steel Plate boots, he picked fades, which just gives you health. So now they're crashing the Herald in the top lane. But this is where, like, this is like, I was watching a lesson on this, and he made a really nice argument here. It's not good to take turret so early, because after that the top laners tend to roam around the map, and they're losing a lot of CS. So as you can see, before crashing the Herald and taking the whole turret, Jace is almost 20 CS ahead of Gnar. And he can play the laner whichever he wants. So he can freeze and make the difference even higher. He can slow push and have Lee Sin kill Gnar, but without taking this turret. But by taking this turret so early, Gnar can freeze the lane, because not only did they take the first one, they also went for the second one, for the tier 2. So now Gnar can freeze right here. Jace will have to rotate and roam around the map. It's still not a good time. It's very early to make the complete rotation, where usually the bottom lane goes mid and then the solo laners push on the side lane. It's too early for that. They took the towers so early, and you might think that, you know, this is putting Jace far ahead, but it doesn't. at least in pro play, because pro players know, like, by now they have understood that when they're losing so bad, they need to freeze right here. So even though it looks a good thing for Jace and his team, it really isn't. Because now Gnar is gonna freeze the lane, and he's gonna reduce the CS lead and the gold lead that Jace has over him over the first 10 minutes of the game. So now look at the minimap. You see, Jace is just, you know, walking around with Lee Sin. Then he goes mid. He's gonna share the experience with Orianna, which is not a good thing. You don't want to do. And Gnar, you see now, we left it at almost 20 CS lead for Jace. Now they're equal. And Gnar had the chance to actually pass him. He could get level. This is, like, I remember a last stream. This is the point where he said that he was willing to bet that Gnar was going to hit level 10 before Jace, just because he's freezing and Jace has to just roam around and share waves XP. But there was a bad decision making from Gnar to push the wave, so he missed that opportunity. Jace figured out that, you know, he doesn't, like, basically what he did was not worth, because Gnar is getting back on gold, and that's why this is where the mistake happened. So Gnar decided to push the wave, and now Jace is gonna catch it, and that's why he was able to again retain his gold lead and his CS lead, and he also hit level 10 first because of that Canyon minion wave. So, like, most of you, like I said, in terms of solo queue logic, yes, like, getting towers early, tilting the enemy team is nice, but this is competitive play, teams are coordinated, so we're not gonna have a lot of kills at this point. That's why Gnar has the chance to freeze the lane. He knows about these concepts, and I mean, it was a nightmare for him. It started as a nightmare in the first 10 minutes, but now at least he managed to equal Jace in terms of CS, and I can't see the gold, but for sure he reduced their difference on gold lead. And here UOL managed to pick up Leona, which overstepped a bit, so now they're going for the second Herald of the game. But Heralds after 40 minutes are not so worth if the other team defends their lanes properly, because their turret plates are gone. So if the tower has more than 50% of HP, they can't get much with the second Herald charge. So as you can see, Gnar is doing the same. He's just chilling, freezing, trying to reduce the gold lead that Chase has, so that he can be useful on his team, even though he's a useless champion, like I said. Now Jace has to catch the bottom wave, which was taken from DFM. And we're gonna have a dragon fight, as it seems. Yeah, they deleted Rakan, and it's also what I mentioned about Rakan and Lucian. So they lost lane, they lost bottom lane, and I don't see them coordinated well enough in the team fights. Because Rakan has to go in and engage with Orianna's ball, and Lucian is just fronted back. So this was a really nice shockwave here from Nomans, right here. It was a nice shockwave, but also a nice MF ultimate, which is gonna buy time for DFM jungler to pick up the second Drake of the game. And you see, this is what I said earlier, even if they summon Herald, yes, they might take this tower, but they're not gonna get any real goals from that. And to answer some of your concerns, like, what should UOL have done with the first Herald? They should have picked either mid lane or bot lane to crash it there, because when they crashed it top, DFM's mid and bot turrets were all there. So they had five turrets on mid, they had five plates on mid and bot. So UOL could have crashed Herald on either mid or bot and gained some gold lead from there as well. So here, I think, yeah, they caught Nomans again. No vision, so he's trying to, like, it's a very long way to reach that wave and push it, so he had no business being there. He also got caught later on in the game, again when he was trying to catch these top waves. Was it here, actually? Yeah, so he's trying to defend here, trying to catch a wave, but he's going back because he doesn't have any vision. He's checking his jungle, but Leona is there and they're gonna catch him again. So he overstayed. Like, checking their jungle is fine. I mean, if he doesn't have wards, he has to take the risk to check it, and let his jungler know what camps are missing and if he himself is in danger. But he overstayed and Leona roamed there. Nice read from DFM. So they caught him up two times in the top side, and that's why LeBlanc now has a huge gold advantage. With all of this discussion, Talon has managed to pick four out of the five kills that from his team. Yeah, so let's check this fight right here. So Unicorns of Love now managed to get this dragon, which is a mountain drake. So if they get Mountain Soul, they can win this game. They can turn this game around. But here, instead of trying to retreat towards their bot side and just reset, they decided to engage. And here, like, it's really strange that the only engage champion that they have is Rakan. And at the same time, he is the support, so he has to also go back and peel for Lucian. So they got caught here. Lucian got killed. So yeah, the whole point was that they should retreat after Dragon. They took the objective. They burned some of their spells to take down that dragon, and they also had an escape route from here, from their bottom lane, to just reset. But they didn't, and now they put DFM on the. I think it's the first time in the game that DFM have more gold lead from Unicorns. Yeah, so they managed to somehow zone Gnar as he was about to enter, but at the same time, look at this. Lucian is right here, he's on the front line, so he got that. Actually, that this is a really nice Leona ultimate. So really nice ultimate from Leona. Lucian is on the front line trying to finish off Gnar, which was not gonna be easy, no matter how useless the champion is. So they got the pick, and now they can snowball much better. Now let's check this point. So DFM don't want to let Orianna push on a side lane. They got here like two or three times by now, and Orianna is trying to keep push. And the thing is that the wave to push is so far that basically she's vulnerable from a lot of sides. That's why Lee Sin was with her at this moment, but it doesn't matter because the rest of the team are just came out of base and they're trying to catch the waves on the other lanes. So here, Orianna and Lee Sin are overextended once more. Talon can easily close the distance with his jumps. That's why they made him a good jungler. So yeah, they got Orianna again. No mans cannot play the game. They got Jayce again. Lucian is overstepped for some reason, and he doesn't match as well with Lucian. And it's a free Baron now for DM from DFM, increasing their lead even more. So after that, we are go like I'm gonna show you one more team fight, which decided the game. But the game, like, if DFM didn't do any mistakes or any throws, the game is pretty much sealed for them. And also one more thing, let's talk about Orianna's push. So let's look at the objectives. Baron is up. And we are at the 25th minute of the game almost, so the teams are capable enough of taking down Baron. And the next dragon is coming up in 2 minutes. So usually what teams are doing at this stage of the game, they pick an objective and they try to make the side that this objective is, they try to take over that side of the map as their strong side. So here, I mean, Orianna and Lee Sin are trying to push this wave mostly to cover Orianna, but look their support. So usually their whole team should be coordinated and cover this area right here and make it their strong side to bait DFM for Baron. Okay? But they are so split everywhere. Probably they had different reset timings. So they don't have wards, they don't have their support with them. Jace is on bottom side, he has TP, but he also has to catch this wave and push this side lane. And Lucian is on mid. So basically, the main point is that they don't have Rakan, and Lucian has to push this wave first in order to move into this area, in order for them to secure this area as their strong pick. As their strong pick. Sorry, their strong side. So they are overextended, and it what happened happened. We saw that, and this is the last crucial fight of the game, because Unicorns of Love wanted the mountains all so bad, but they had to kill three more drakes. Now their plan is to deny it from DFM, otherwise they're gonna lose. They are already behind. If DFM gets the mountain soul, they're gonna be more tanky, especially Leona and Gnar, and they're gonna lose the game. So they have to fight for that. So again, their only engage option is Rakan. This is a nice Lucian ultimate, but you know, he just did it on Leona, and look at LeBlanc's W. So LeBlanc is right here. Look at like one W. One W brought Lucian to his 30% of HP. Just one W. So of course now they are outzoned. They don't have much options. DFM are playing this very cautiously. So now No Man's teleported back. I mean, they really want to deny it, so they're gonna do their best. But nice zoning here from Leona, Gnar, and LeBlanc. So DFM got Mountain Soul. They got all the skills. Did they ace them? I don't remember. I'm not sure if they aced them. They're gonna get Talon, are they? I mean, they're chasing them until the Earth's deep end. Yeah, No Man's here thought that he can kill Steel, but even if he had, he would have died anyway. So yeah, it's an unofficial ace for DFM, and from that point on, they took the second Baron and they managed to end the game. So really dominant win from DFM, and everything started from the fact that Jace actually took the first two turrets so early with Lee Sin, and allowed Gnar to freeze that lane. So then they had to move around, and basically they didn't manage to take advantage of that gold lead that they had in the first 10 minutes of the game. So thanks for watching, and GG.